Okay. So welcome to the final lecture of the Edmund J. Safra Center for Ethics Lab on Institutional Corruption. My name is, well, if you don't know my name by now, it doesn't really matter much because it's the last time I have the honor of introducing a Safra lecture. It's my pleasure this evening to welcome Tyrone Hayes to give the lecture. Tyrone was born and raised in Columbia, South Carolina. He's provided a really interesting biography, which I'd love to share a bit with you about. As he wrote in his biography, he was encouraged by his parents, Romeo and Susie Hayes, and inspired by the wildlife around him, hiking in Congaree Swamp, reading National Geographic magazine, watching the television show Wild Kingdom. He developed an interest in biology very early in his childhood. In particular, he was fascinated by amphibians and the influence that environmental changes have on their development, growth, and reproduction. After graduating from high school, Professor Hayes attended Harvard. He graduated in 1999, writing an honors thesis on the influence of temperature on larval growth, development, metamorphosis, and sex differentiation in wood frogs. He then went to the Department of Integrative Biology at the University of California, Berkeley, for his PhD. After completing his PhD in 1993, he did postdoctoral work at the National Institute of Child Health and Human Development, National Institute of Health, and the Cancer Research Laboratories at Berkeley. In 1994, he joined the faculty at Berkeley as an assistant professor. Through his research, Professor Hayes began to recognize that the most important environmental factors affecting amphibian development were synthetic chemicals, such as pesticides, that interact with hormones in a variety of ways that alter developmental responses. In 1998, after receiving his tenured appointment at Berkeley, Professor Hayes began consulting with and conducting research for Novartis, which eventually became the agrochemical giant Syngenta. But over time, his lab showed that the herbicide atrazine, the number one selling product for Syngenta, was a potent endocrine disruptor, chemically castrating and feminizing exposed male amphibians at low ecologically relevant concentrations. Syngenta was not enthusiastic about these findings. The company and their contracted consultant, EcoRisk Inc., prevented Hayes from presenting his data at scientific meetings or publishing much of the results. So in 2000, he resigned his consulting position with the company and published his work with independent funding. In 2003, he was promoted to a full professorship at Berkeley, despite the continued efforts by his former sponsor to discredit his work. These efforts were described extensively in The New Yorker last year. I'm honored that he has come across country to tell his story and to give us a chance to understand what it might mean for the subject that we've been considering these past 5 years. Please join me in welcoming Tyrone Hayes to present the final lecture for the series.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you all for coming out. It's been a few years since I've been on the campus. I got a little lost on the way. I'm going to tell you a story tonight from Silent Spring to Silent Night, A Tale of Toads and Men. But before I tell the story, I have sort of a tradition, or I guess non-tradition, the way that I do things, is I always do my acknowledgments or my thank yous first. I always thank the people who made me who I am. That way, if I run out of time, the really important stuff is done first. First and foremost, I want to thank my family for their love and support. I think probably because of this, I'm not allowed to be in the family photographs anymore, but this is an older photograph. But first and foremost, my father, my mother, Romeo and Susie Hayes. I'm a biologist. Without them, I truly would not be here. My wife, Catherine Kim, my daughter, Cassina, and my son, Tyler. And also a special shout out to my daughter. She's right now in Philadelphia competing in the National Gymnastics Competition. I missed it. She just qualified, but I'll be there tomorrow to see the final. So shout out to her. And I also want to thank my funding sources. Takes money to do science. You have to be creative these days. And also, as you heard, I have been funded by the chemical industry, which is sort of the focus of the talk, the presentation tonight. We'll get to why they don't want to hang out with me so much as we go through. I also want to thank the students that have been involved. in particular, everybody in blue is an undergraduate. I had a wonderful experience as an undergraduate here at Harvard myself, and I'm doing my best now as a professor to give back what my professor gave to me. So shout out to them, and also to my current laboratory. There is at least one guy. He wasn't present for the photo. But above all else, I'm really thankful that I'm allowed to teach and mentor such a diverse group of students, including students from various ethnic backgrounds, first generation, low income, and a number of students whose families actually work in agriculture, which is really important that I'm able to serve the community in this way. And finally, I want to dedicate this to my grandmother, who, in addition to passing on to me her love of teaching and her desire to make the world a better place through education before she herself passed on, she also taught me something that, quite frankly, you can't really learn at places like Harvard and Berkeley. She taught me that if you really want to get a point across, you don't lecture, you don't preach, you don't teach, you don't give talks, you don't give presentations, you just tell a good story. And so I'd like to tell you a story tonight. And the story starts and ends with a little boy who likes frogs. This photograph is a book that my mom sent me when my son was born. And she wrote a note in the book that said, "This was your dad's favorite book." And as I always tell people, I don't remember the book. But my mama don't lie. If she says, "This was my favorite book," it was my favorite book. What I remember is that I've been trying to answer this question, what is a frog, for as long as I can remember. And I tell a long, drawn-out story about growing up in South Carolina and in a Congaree swamp and how I got here. But in the interest of time, and also because I want to talk more about some of the issues that are relevant to this group, I'm going to skip that part of the story. I'll start off here, where here I am as a 19-year-old with Bruce Waldman, who was a professor here in Organismic and Evolutionary Biology when I was an undergraduate. I worked with him for 4 years, and here is where I got my professional start in biology, with an interest in how the environment influences development and how an amphibian, and now animals in general, ability to respond to environmental changes have evolved. Somewhere along the way, as I became a new assistant professor, I started working with these guys, the African clawed frogs, Xenopus laevis. And I'm assuming there are not that many biologists in the audience tonight. Correct? Who's a biologist? I recognize at least one. That's two. This is the frog that I often call the lab rat of the animal kingdom. This is the frog who everybody who does developmental biology and molecular biology started working on, the African clawed frog, for an interesting reason that I'm assuming nobody in the audience knows. The reason that everybody studies this frog is not because it's the best frog. In fact, it doesn't have a tongue. It can't hop. So it's not the best frog. But the reason everybody studies it is because in 1920, somebody discovered that the human pregnancy hormone, HCG, will make this frog lay eggs. So by 1940, this frog was the pregnancy test. Literally in 1940, if you thought you were pregnant, you would go to the doctor and they would inject some of your urine into the frog and the frog laid eggs. Well, you were either happy or sad depending on your situation. And I tell this story to set the stage for my broader story for a couple of reasons. One is it shows you the value of curiosity-based research, right? As scientists funded by National Science Foundation, et cetera, we're always under, you know, sort of under the scrutiny, right? But who was the first guy, for example, who thought, you know, I wonder what'll happen if I inject pee into a frog? Like, how did that ever get discovered? But the point is that curiosity-based research led to something that was incredibly important, a pregnancy test, so that you can know if you were pregnant or not and maybe change your health status or whatever. The second reason I tell this story is it shows the importance of amphibian models and other animal models in biological research. And it shows you how other animals can tell us things about ourselves, like the pregnancy test. In other words, the hormones that we use are so similar to the hormones that frogs use that our pregnancy hormone, the hormone that was responsible for all of us and for all of our children, is so similar to this frog's hormones that it'll make this frog lay eggs. So as they tell you what atrazine does to hormones in frogs, you should also be thinking, well, what might atrazine, this chemical I'll talk to you about, do to us if our hormones are so similar? The third reason I tell the story is it's really sort of a practical one. You see, they developed other pregnancy tests after the frog tests. And then hospitals and et cetera just threw the frogs out when they were done. So in fact, I can go to San Diego or San Francisco and collect African clawed frogs for my research without having to pay for them, which technically means that I study African-American clawed frogs, but that's just that's a small detail that's not exactly relevant to this story. At any rate, at some point along the way, as a new assistant professor, this little chemical company came to me and said, we want you to use your frogs to help us understand if this chemical atrazine is an endocrine disruptor. In other words, does this chemical interfere with hormones in animals? And I had never heard of atrazine. You know, I was just a little boy who likes frogs, studying frog development. Here's what it looks like. It's amazing now how much chemistry I have to deal with. In fact, I got heart murmurs when I came on this campus again because chemistry almost got me kicked out of school here. It was so nice, I took it twice. I'm not exaggerating. Now, we're connected to the carbon bond. If you Google Tyrone, you get atrazine. If you Google atrazine, you get Tyrone. I can't get away from it. At any rate, it's this chemical in particular is an herbicide. It's a weed killer. Again, I had never heard of it. But at the time, it had been used since 1958, and it was the number one selling pesticide in the world when I got asked as a new assistant professor in 1998 to start to review the chemical. At the time, we were using 80 million pounds of atrazine a year. That's a lot. At the time, and still, it was used in more than 80 countries, but since then has been outlawed in all of Europe. And I leave this slide, I should be careful here because I am in the law school. The chemical company's lawyers write me lots of letters. They don't like this slide because they say that the chemical has not been outlawed in all of Europe. They say the chemical has been denied regulatory approval by the European Union. Now, maybe the people in this room, being at the law school, maybe you understand the difference more than I do. I don't. But I leave this slide up because I know that this one pisses them off. What can I say? That's just the kind of brother I am. The other things that are important here is that it's been outlawed or denied regulatory approval by the European Union, yet we're still using 80 million pounds in this country. The company itself is based in Europe. So we're using 80 million pounds of a chemical that's not allowed on the continent that the company calls home. So at any rate, we did some studies where we just exposed frogs to ecologically relevant, to levels of atrazine that you might find in the environment. And we literally just asked, our hypothesis was, does it do anything? And we measured a bunch of things that were known to be regulated by hormones. And we identified that if you expose tadpoles of this species to atrazine that inhibited growth of the voice box or the larynx in exposed frogs. And the company didn't like that so much, in part because male frogs sing and females don't or have a different song for the same reason that human males have deeper voices than females, testosterone. So this finding, these data implied that somehow atrazine was reducing the testosterone in exposed animals, which is not what you want to hear when you're talking about your number one selling product for your company. So here's how we did that. Here's what the larynx looks like. So this is a larynx or voice box that's been dissected from a frog. These are the thyroid glands, but that's sort of irrelevant. Here's what it looks like on the other side. And what we did is we made thin sections and looked at these sections under the microscope. And here's what that looks like. And then we just measured the largest portion, either one of these, of the larynx. So we measured the largest cross-sectional area. We gave every male the best score that he could have. Because a male with a big muscle or a big larynx is the male who's going to be able to sing the better song and attract the females. And what we showed while I was under contract for this company, again, I was a professor at UC Berkeley, but also under contract, is we showed that if you increase exposure to atrazine, you actually hit sort of a threshold where you reduce the size of the larynx of individual animals. So on average, their larynx or their voice box was smaller. They were demasculinized, if you will. And again, the company didn't like that so much. The other way that we looked at the data, which was sort of new for an endocrinologist, is we actually sort of looked at it from a population perspective. So in addition to asking, how small is your larynx if you're exposed to more and more atrazine? We also asked, what is the impact on the population? So how many individuals in a population have a reduced voice box size if they're exposed to atrazine? So starting at about 0.1 or 1 part per billion, 0.1 to 0.1, and I'll give you an idea of what that number means in a minute. you start to get a reduced larynx size, but you also start to, at about one part per billion, get a greater proportion. 80% of the population has a substandard size larynx. So it's a way of not asking, so it's a way of saying, I don't care how small your larynx is as an individual, but how many individuals in a population are impacted. So if you think of it in terms of cancer, it's like saying, on this side, it's like saying, how bad is your cancer? And on this side, it's like saying, I don't care how bad your cancer is, but how many of you have cancer if you're exposed? So there are two different ways of looking at the data. So in terms of the, scandal and ethical issues, the first problem I had with the company is they actually started asking me to manipulate the data. So the first thing they said was, okay, yeah, we gave them enough data points. They said, okay, yeah, there's a problem. But then a big person in the company said, well, there's a simple solution. You just divide by the body weight and the problem goes away. And I tried to explain to the company at the time, and I should also say at the time I was really in the running. I was a big runner. I was running like 15, 20 miles a day. And so my calves actually kind of looked like this. They were quite impressive. And compared to my daughter's, who was about 5 years old. And so I said to them, I said, look, I can measure the circumference of my calf and my daughter's calf. And I can calculate the area of my calf and my daughter's calf. So obviously my calf was bigger than my daughter's calf. But if I divide by body weight, like you're asking, it actually makes my daughter look like she's bigger than I am. So I said, this is inappropriate because you're dividing by a two-dimensional measure by a three-dimensional measure, and it actually is an inappropriate way to express the data. And I sort of naively thought, well, they just didn't understand this morphometric, if you will. But they insisted that this is how we should present the data. So eventually things went on, and I'll tell you more and more about what happened with the company and how we interacted. But I refused to present the data this way, and then they refused to allow me to present the data in the way it needed to be presented. That created some problems. The next step is I decided to try to find out why the larynx or the voice box was impacted. You need testosterone in order to have a big masculine larynx, and testosterone comes from the gonads. So I decided to examine the gonads and just try to figure out, well, what might atrazine be doing to the gonads. So for example, these are the kidneys dissected from a larva that's been exposed to atrazine. And then on top of the kidneys, sort of ventral to, if you will, are the gonads. So for example, here are testes, which sort of by definition, every good male should have a pair. But also you'll notice in this individual that these long structures are ovaries. Then there's another large testis. And then there's more ovaries, which is not exactly what you expect to see in frogs. And I put this up for a couple of reasons. One is I've been talking about this stuff now for almost 20 years, and inevitably somebody in the audience says, well, aren't frogs naturally hermaphroditic, naturally mixed sex? And I've asked around now, and I figured out the reason that people think that. Did you say it? Jurassic Park, exactly. So apparently, in Jurassic Park, it took me 15 years to figure out why people think this way. And I read the book and saw the movie. Apparently in Jurassic Park, it was frog DNA that made the dinosaurs change sex, and that's in everybody's minds, whether you're a biologist or not. But this is not normal. There are not frogs that are naturally hermaphroditic. There are some fish that are naturally hermaphroditic, but there are no frogs, at least to my knowledge, that are naturally hermaphroditic. This will also come back again because the company also started to tell people in sort of public venues that, well, it's just a natural phenomenon, Hayes is making a big deal out of nothing. I don't believe that's the case. So we made a hypothesis that the following was happening. If you imagine that this ellipse here is your testicle, or maybe imagine somebody from Yale, because we're gonna do some not so nice things. If you have a testicle, you should make testosterone. This word, if in case you don't know, is what's called a portmanteau. Who knows that word? It means testicular hormone. It's two words stuck together. Like smoke and fog, you get smog. Twist and jerk, you get twerk. If you stick testicular hormone together, you get this one word, testosterone. If you have a testicle, you should make, or testicles, you should make the testicular hormone testosterone. So our hypothesis was that atrazine induced an enzyme, the machinery, if you will, aromatase, and I want you to remember this word, it's gonna come up multiple times. This enzyme, this machinery, converts testosterone into estrogen, another portmanteau, which means the generator of estrus. That's where the word estrogen comes from. And so the idea is that if you're exposed to atrazine, two things are happening. And it's a little more complicated than this biologically, but more or less, you're using up your testosterone, so you're demasculinized. You don't have enough of the male hormone. But you're also, so for example, your larynx won't grow. But you're also subsequently feminized because now you're making the female hormone, which is probably okay if you're a female, maybe not so much if you're a male. So we tested this in a number of ways. I'll tell you about other ways later. But in the simplest way, we just measured levels of hormones in adult frogs that were exposed to atrazine. And so these are actually daytime levels of testosterone. They can go up to about 20 or 30 times higher at night. And these are atrazine-treated males, and these are control females. So we showed that these atrazine-treated males had testosterone levels that weren't different from a female, that were definitely reduced relative to unexposed males. Now, by this time, we had, just to give you an idea of where we are in my story, by this time, the company has decided not going to deal with Tyrone anymore. They're gone. We're doing our own thing. We got our own funding. And I'm coming up for tenure. And so we published a paper, because we were able to do this with our own funding. We published this paper, hermaphroditic demasculinized frogs after exposure to the herbicide atrazine at low ecologically relevant doses. Yeah, if you work for the company, this is like not a title you want to see. But not only that, it was published in PNAS, Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. You guys know PNAS? Okay, so personal part of the story is, I'm an assistant professor, I'm coming up for tenure. I call my mom, because PNAS is a big deal, right? I call my mom. I said, Mom, I have a paper coming out in PNAS. She drops the phone, silence. I said, Mom, I have a paper. She said, yeah, I heard you. I'm just wondering how you get a paper cut on your penis. And I said, no, Mom. I said, PNAS. And if you're British, it sounds even worse because they call it PNAS. I said, no. The important part of the story, and it's 100% true, my mom calls me back the next week, and she says, how important is that magazine you're talking about? I said, Mom, PNAS, it's a big deal. She said, oh, because I went to Barnes & Noble, and they never heard of that magazine. I'm going to come back to this in a little bit. It's an incredibly important part of the story. This is now my most important. I did get tenure, by the way. Otherwise, I certainly wouldn't be here now. This is now my most important publication. It's a kid's book for fifth graders that I didn't even write, but my mom can go and buy it in Barnes & Noble. I'm going to tell you why that's important as we come back to the end of the story. The company responded at this first publication, which was basically the stuff I just told you, a little more stuff, but they wrote Sherry Ford, who I'm sure doesn't work for the company anymore for reasons that you'll see later. They wrote, research that we have funded does not support the conclusions that Hayes is drawing from his own research. And they put forth a number of things in the literature, in the scientific literature, to support that claim. They hired a bunch of scientists from several universities under contract, people that I worked with and people that I knew. And some of them, in 2002, for example, when this first came out, made statements like, we have been unable to reproduce the low concentration effects in the larynx and gonads of the Xenopus laevis tadpole that have been reported elsewhere in the scientific literature. So somehow my nickname became elsewhere. Because clearly they were talking about me. But then when the papers actually came out, so this was actually presented before the papers came out, it was kind of interesting. So here's the hermaphrodite that I showed you, right, with testes and ovaries. And here's a picture that they published in their paper where there's testes and ovaries and a large testes and more ovaries. The arrows are pointing to the testes. So in their actual paper, they showed similar things that I showed. So that was kind of confusing. But what's more confusing is if you compare now the frequency of abnormal sex development in frogs from the paper that they published. So these are their data with the arrows. They not only showed the same kind of frequency of abnormalities, but it actually, in many cases, depending on the dose, they showed even higher, for example, there's 25 parts per billion. They showed even higher frequencies of these gonadal abnormalities. So I thought, wow, this is kind of a mystery. And not only that, when they did the statistics, do you guys like statistics and p-values? Well, kind of. But they showed even like incredibly statistically significant effects of atrazine, much more robust data than even I published in my PNAS paper. But it turns out, and you can go read this, I'm not making this up, this is in the paper, it turns out their claim was that if you drop the highest group, then the data became insignificant. In what study would the data not become insignificant if you throw out the significant group? But I think the charge, and it was all published, they never lied, this was their statement, but I think the charge was that if you can put this out in the public, well, we weren't able to repeat it and not explain why, then it sort of gets people confused. Because as you'll see in a minute, this started to become a public issue. There started to become legislation and regulation issues around the compound. What's more is they published a few other papers. Here's one, for example, that was published by Michigan State University, and they claimed, and here's why I said hermaphrodites are not normal, because they claimed that they saw hermaphrodites even in their controls, even in their untreated animals. But also in that same paper, and I'm going through all this because this is an ethics seminar, right? In that same paper, they reported the atrazine levels in all of their treatment groups. And again, I'm just pulling this straight out of the paper. It's peer-reviewed, it's published, you can go look it up. So here are their atrazine levels. They actually go much higher. I've cut off the axis here. Because the important part is that if you look at their 0.1 parts per billion group, which is where we start to see hermaphrodites, and if you look at their controls, we start to see hermaphrodites again at 0.1 parts per billion. Even their controls had more atrazine, according to their own measurements, than some of our treatment groups. So of course you see hermaphrodites if your controls have as much atrazine as their treatment group, where we start to see hermaphrodites in our group. And they reported in the paper, I'm not making this up, you can read the paper. They reported that they didn't put lids on their tanks like we did. So sometimes the frogs jump from tank to tank and sometimes completely out of the tank. It's reported in the paper. So they report that they're hermaphrodites, but that's not surprising when your treated animals can jump into your control tank and when your control tank has as much atrazine as your... And this is one of my favorites. This came out of Michigan State, another Syngenta-funded study. They wrote, in the conclusion of this publication, they wrote that chronic exposure to 16 or 28 micrograms per liter atrazine, so that's 28 parts per billion, did not affect mortality, growth, sex ratios, or gonadal anomalies in developing R. climatans, is just a species of frog. Therefore, it appears that atrazine in environment and relevant concentrations does not affect growth, development, or gonadal morphology in developing ranaclimatans. It's just a green frog. Here's their mortality data. They all died. They all died. So they did a study where 90% of the animals died, and then they claim, oh, there was no effect. Of course, if I was studying cancer and I treated you guys with all something and you all died, of course I could report, well, nobody got cancer in my study, because they all died. They didn't feed the animals. And so it wasn't a lie. They published this thing, and they reported, well, we didn't see any hermaphrodites, but 90% of your animals died. You didn't have anything to measure. So it was a really interesting phenomenon. In the end, and this is a really old slide, this goes up to 38. In the end, many, many studies were published showing effects of atrazine, adverse effects on reproduction. And green now amphibian studies, these are studies in fish, these are studies in reptiles, these are studies in mammals, and red are epidemiological studies in humans. And there's a very small subset of studies that show no adverse effects. And I published an interesting paper showing, using statistics, to show that, in fact, I could relabel these axes, that on this axis would be independent funding, on this axis would be funding. I did a whole path analysis to show that the single most important factor that determines whether or not you find no adverse effects of atrazine is who funded the actual study. So 100% of these studies were actually funded by the manufacturer that I was originally funded for. So at any rate, like I said, I did get tenure. We published this paper in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. And among other things, I guess, what I haven't pointed out is there were four black men and a Latina co-authored that paper, which is probably a record for the National Academy of Sciences. So this is another thing that I'm very important, that's very important to me. As important as the paper might have been and my tenure, there were a few questions that weren't answered. One, we didn't know if these hermaphrodites were males with ovaries or females with testes. In part, we didn't know this because frogs don't have visible sex chromosomes. So we couldn't actually determine who was a genetic male and who was a genetic female. But we had a good idea because in these studies, when we exposed the atrazine, we might get 50% females, 30% males, and 20% hermaphrodites. So we had a good idea it was the males turning into females. The other thing we didn't know is we didn't know what happens when these animals become adults because we only looked at the little metamorphs. We didn't ask what happens when they grow up. And this seems like an easy question to answer, except that it takes these frogs about 4 years to become sexually mature. So working with undergraduates or even graduate students, you got to get a student in their first year and tell them, hey, you know, I have a good project for you. And maybe by the time you graduate, there might be some data. In fact, it was worse than that. It took about 8 years, and this was the answer. another PNAS paper. And in fact, I love this. I still have the email, and you'll see why in a minute. I sent this photo in because, you know, in the ivory tower, we all want the cover of the magazine, right? So I sent the photo in, and I still have the email from the editor who said, no, I really don't think people are ready for I'm not joking, I still have the email. So it turns out by the time the paper came out, we had collaborators in Japan who had identified a gene called DMW that only females have. So by the time the paper came out, I believe it was 2008, this particular paper, we knew we could tell who was a genetic male and who was a genetic female. So for example, this guy who looks like he's smiling, we could genotype him and determine he's a male, and his friend there is his brother. So by the time the paper came out, at least in this population, we knew that about 10% of the exposed males completely turn into females. And completely. So here's this is a genetic male. They lay eggs and everything. Completely turn into females. Now, I could hear some of the sounds in the audience. I probably could have published that, but I was in no hurry. I had tenure. So I wanted to ask some other questions. Like, well, what about these other 90% that don't turn into females? What happens with them? So we did these studies, I call them the pool party experiments, where we literally put four females in a pool, four control males, four atrazine treated males, everybody was a virgin, nobody had any experience over another. And of course, these aren't for the guys, this of course is not the sex ratio you want in a club that you go to. But the idea is we wanted the females to be limited to see if these atrazine treated males were competent, competitive males. And so we did these experiments. So literally we put them in at 7 p.m. And remember, I did behavioral ecology when I was here at Harvard. So this is, you can blame Bruce Waldman for this kind of design. So we put them in at 7 p.m., the lights go out, you know, we put in a little Marvin Gaye or something like that. And then you come back in the morning at 7 a.m., and we put stitches there, I don't know if you can see those, so we could tell who's who. And then you just look at who got the hookup and who didn't. Okay? And then when you do that, it turns out that these atrazine-treated males, we did four trials, actually we did five, but on one of them, one of the students kicked the pool and then we couldn't see who was together. But when you do these, you find that the atrazine-treated males almost never get the female. Almost never. So then, of course, I'm an endocrinologist. So I started off as a behavioral ecologist here. As somebody who studies hormones, I can't just observe. I got to stick a needle in the animal and get some blood out or something. So imagine you're at the club, the lights comes on, somebody's taking names, and then somebody sticks a needle in your heart and takes a blood sample. That's how this went down. So when you do that, as you might guess, the controls, which I've depicted in black here, have much more testosterone on average than the atrazine-treated males that I've depicted in red. But what's more important is if you look at the individual hormone levels, if you look at, if you will, who made the love connection, that males who make the love connection, who win, have much higher testosterone. It's almost like there's a cutoff, and if you're below this cutoff, either females don't like you, or you're getting the crap beat out of you by these other males. The point is you lose. So testosterone's incredibly important. And if you're exposed to atrazine, you don't have enough testosterone to be competitive. Well, then we did a series of, because I could have published that, right? But again, I had tenure. I was in no hurry. We did a series of experiments that I often refer to as the Motel 6 experiments. In this case, we just got each male a room and a female. We isolated them in tanks like these, and we just asked, without any competition, can you fertilize eggs? Are you competent? Because you kind of can't do a sperm count in frogs. And so what we do is we leave them overnight, we collect the eggs after they've been together with a control or an atrazine-exposed animal, and then we count how many eggs are unfertilized, like this one, after a couple days, versus how many are fertilized. So yeah, literally, there's an undergraduate sitting in a room going, one, two, three. The point is, if you do that, you find out that control males fertilize about 85% of a female's eggs, whereas atrazine-treated males fertilize only about 15%. So even though they don't turn into females, those 90% that aren't completely feminized, they're demasculinized in a sense that they're not competitive, and even without competition, they're not competent. And they're not competent for what I would say are two reasons. I'm going to tell you the two published reasons, but then there's a third reason why they're not competent. The first reason they're not competent, which I can't show you here because I don't have video, is they don't even try. Even without competition, they just sit there and watch the females lay eggs. They don't even try. They don't sing. They don't try to grab onto them. So they're duds. But even if they try, they don't have enough sperm to perform. So for example, we talked about, you guys said you like p-values, right? You know what I like better than p-values? I like when you can just see the difference. And we measured this, we put a p-value on it, but what I love is that I could take photographs, these are slices through testis of exposed and unexposed animals, and I could just show them to students and say, hey, put them in the two piles. Because what's happened is these control animals, if you look at the testicular tubules, they're all full of sperm. See all those dark heads? Those are all soldiers ready to go. If you look at the atrazine-treated animals, that's a testicular tubule that basically has cellular debris. So even if they perform, even if they show reproductive behavior, they don't have enough testosterone to maintain the sperm. So by then, now I figured we were done. We published another PNAS paper. Atrazine induces complete feminization and chemical castration in male African clawed frogs. The company hates that word, chemical castration. That's why I put it in the title. Because that's the kind of brother I am. But not only that, there's 8 undergraduates co-authored the paper. Every one of them on here now has either an MD or a PhD and a Morehouse man. Incredibly important to me, in addition to getting the science done. This work is now unpublished. The third reason that these guys don't perform, don't compete, is because they turns out they aren't interested. I had a student, Nak Mai Nguyen, she was an undergraduate. She's now a graduate student. She just passed her qualifying exam. And she was in charge of trying to do a study to show whether or not there was variability in the sensitivity of different lineages or families of frogs, if you will, in the species. And she said, well, it takes me a long time to clean the cages because I have to pull them apart. I said, what do you mean you have to pull them apart? Because I knew they were all males, these tanks of 40 tubs. And then she showed me this. And then she showed me things like this. These two are coming in, trying to get in. So these males were, you know, to use the young people's language, hooking up in the tanks, right? So not only are they not competing for females, it appears that they might not even be interested. And we went through a number of studies that I don't have time to tell you about because I want to talk more about the kind of stuff the company did. But our first hypothesis is, well, they've never seen females, and they're all males, and maybe it's just big males overpowering little males. There's actually a term for that in the literature called the prison effect. And I'm careful about how I use my term, but that term is in the psychological literature. So it turns out, though, that that's not true. So the ones on the bottom, it turns out, so these are the pairs. So this is just one day that we pulled the pairs out of 40 animals. These groups were in a pair. What is that? 5 of them. So about 5 to 7 per day. And the ones on the bottom are almost always bigger, which is interesting because females are bigger in the species. So the ones on the bottom, these are all males, are almost always bigger, and the ones on the bottom are always the same individuals. So it's not like it's just random hookups. These individuals are driving the behavior. So again, I'm an endocrinologist. I have to measure something. I can't just observe. If you look at testosterone levels, the ones on the top have higher testosterone levels. But what's interesting is if you look in the bottom, the ones on the bottom have estrogen levels and an estrogen-testosterone ratio. Even though they're males, they have hormone levels that look like female levels. So we think that they're producing enough estrogen that they think that they're females, even though their bodies and their gonads are male. And my undergraduate has now moved on as a graduate student to study the brain morphology and how the brains of these animals may be sex reversed, if you will, and might contribute to this behavior. Well, now the next thing we did, and this part's actually published in another one of those magazines that my mom can't get at Barnes & Noble, we published this work in Nature. As we went on to ask, is this phenomenon only present in African clawed frogs, or do you see it in other frogs? So we looked at the North American leopard frog, and here's an animal that's not a hermaphrodite, but you see here's testis, and here's what I call the junk in the trunk, right? Here's, you see all this lumpy stuff? These are eggs that are bursting through the surface of this male's testis. Now, to give you an idea, because this, you know, seminar's about ethics and things, I broke embargo. The paper got accepted to Nature, and I'm coming up for full professor, by the way, but I sent the data ahead of time to the Environmental Protection Agency because I said, look, I think this is pretty important. And I still have the email. Tom Steger, the EPA, he emailed me back and he said, well, thanks, Dr. Hayes. Thanks, Dr. Hayes. He said, this is an interesting finding. However, we do not see it as an adverse effect that would trigger reassessment and regulation of atrazine. Now, not to be sexist, but can I talk to just the guys in the room for a second? Because my wife tells me, and my mom, that there is nothing more painful in life than childbirth. going to have to give them that. But are the rest of you with me, Y chromosomes? That a dozen chicken eggs in your testicle would have to be in the top five, right? Maybe not as painful as childbirth, but it would have to register, you think? EPA says, no, don't worry about it. Keep spraying it. And so the reason that we did the stuff with the North American leopard frog is that we wanted to figure out how prevalent this might be in the environment. And to give you an idea, because the Environmental Protection Agency, the ones who sort of care about this, to give you an idea, because this is an ethics seminar, how the EPA would just sort of brush that off, because you might be wondering, wow, why wouldn't you even look at it? Well, there's a whole bunch of levels of regulation when it comes to the EPA, for example. The EPA regulates Syngenta. That's their job. They regulate the chemical manufacturer. Another level of regulation is Syngenta is required to have a scientific advisory board, and they hire these study panels. So I was on one of these study panels that EPA requires Syngenta to have. And then they contract out labs. So I was actually in one of these contract labs, and they report back to the study panel. The study panel then can publish things in the scientific journal. They wouldn't let a brother publish, but that's what you're supposed to do. And the contract labs themselves can publish in scientific journals. And they're not supposed to go back up to Syngenta and back to the EPA, right? That's a lot of regulation. The EPA itself, though, has an EPA scientific advisory panel that tells the EPA what they're supposed to do. And that scientific advisory panel, with regards to hormone-regulated things, is supposed to respond to EDSTAC, the Endocrine Disruptor Screening and Testing Committee. So there's a whole level of regulation. Except that it turns out the scientific advisory board for Syngenta was run by a guy named Ron Kendall. Ron Kendall also was on EDSTAC for the EPA at the exact same time. This guy was also on the EPA's, in fact, he was the chair of the EPA's scientific advisory board at the same time, and he was the chair of the study panel that I was served on. This is the guy who was writing my check. He ran the contract labs that published all that work that I just told you about, that with the dead animals and stuff. And not only that, he was the editor of Environmental Toxicology and Chemistry, where all of the work was published. So there was a little bit of a breakdown in the regulation. So this was another reason that a brother decided, you know, maybe I want to distance myself from this situation. At any rate, we went on to examine whether or not these effects occur in the wild, independent of all the EPA's recommendations and the Syngenta recommendations. And we went on to ask if effects occur in the wild. So to give you an idea, I've been throwing around terms like 0.1 parts per billion. To give you an idea what that means, 0.1 parts per billion is 0.1 micrograms per liter. That's 100 nanograms per liter. That's 100 picograms per mil, which might mean nothing to you. So here's a visual. That's about 1/1,000th of a grain of salt in 2 liters. Which sounds like nothing, but that's about 100 times higher than hormones are active, but it's about 1/1,000th of a grain of salt. Now, the package of atrazine recommends application at 2.9 to 29 million parts per billion. So a farmer might be applying this stuff at levels that are 290 million times higher than we're using in the laboratory, to give you an idea. To give you an idea, agriculture runoff can have minimum and maximum levels that look like this. Temporary pools look like this. Permanent water can look like this. Precipitation can look like this. Here's the levels that we use in the laboratory. So there's enough atrazine in rainwater to chemically castrate and feminize exposed frogs up to 100 times. It goes up on dust. It can travel 1,000 kilometers. That's 600 miles for Americans. And it can come down in rainwater. 500,000 pounds of atrazine come down in the rainwater every year in the United States. What's more is the EPA says the drinking water standard is 3 parts per billion. That's 30 times higher than we know to be biologically effective. In fact, the Environmental Health and Safety Group at the university wrote me a letter and said, Dr. Hayes, we're concerned about your experiments. What are you going to do with the wastewater? And I wrote them back and I said, well, I'm going to take it home and drink it because it's guaranteed to be the... See, I thought that was funny too. Not so much EHS. Got me in a lot of trouble. Anyway, the idea is these are animals that we collected from the wild. This is an example. Here's kidneys. Here's gonads. Just imagine I'm slicing up a salami and staining it with a dye under the microscope. If you look at the gonads of these exposed animals in the wild now, this is no longer in the lab. Here's a testicular tubule. Here's a testicular tubule. Instead of sperm, they have eggs growing in their testes. In fact, I coined the word testicular oocytes, and this is from a Nature paper. And the company lawyer wrote me a letter. They said, that's not a word. I wrote them back. I said, what the Harvard? I can make up a word. Testicular oocytes, that's what they are. They're oocytes in a testicle. Isn't every word not a word before you make it up? I don't know, I'm just saying. So anyway, the idea is we did a study. We studied frogs across the United States. The red is where most of the atrazine is used and present. And we did a study where we control for latitude. And in fact, I'm just being obnoxious. This is Highway I-80. And we were going to a meeting in Indiana, and we collected frogs along the way and got a nature paper. That's fuel efficiency right there. And what we found was every place we found atrazine, we found hermaphrodites and vice versa. The paper, however, wasn't published just because of the correlation. The paper was published because we also had laboratory data to show that we could take animals from here and expose them to atrazine and produce hermaphrodites, or we could take animals from here and expose them to clean water in the lab and they wouldn't come out as hermaphrodites. In other words, it wasn't just population variation. There was a real cause and effect situation that we had demonstrated. I'm not going to tell you that atrazine is the cause of amphibian declines, but I published a paper with my graduate students showing that among the five most ultimate causes for amphibian declines, and 70% of all species of amphibians in the world are in some decline, the biggest loss is habitat loss. I think that's pretty clear. But when you're living in a place like California where the only water that's available to reproduce is agriculture runoff that's filled with chemicals that interact with things like climate change and invasive species and new diseases, the chemicals that are in the water become pretty important in that equation. I use this slide to illustrate the further importance of not just atrazine but other chemicals in this issue. This is from a place called Lake Nabugabo in Uganda. And the runoff from this crop, which is the sole source of drinking and cooking water for the village nearby, I think illustrates the oneness of environmental health and public health in this situation. Compared to when you look at, you know, here's my village, Oakland, I just live somewhere here, but my water just comes from there. And we make these assumptions that, well, there's nothing bad in the water. But I'm telling you that even with our fancy standards, there are things that are relevant to our health. So I call this from silent spring to silent night because in much the same way that Rachel Carson taught that chemicals in the environment and their impact on birds and our, at the time, pending silent spring was important to us. I similarly believe that the chemicals in the environment and the decline of amphibians and the importance of chemicals in that decline are also relevant to us in our new canary in the coal mine, if you will. A colleague of mine wrote in Ecoepidemiology, the occurrence of an association in more than one species and species population is very strong evidence for causation. And I've told you, though, about not just correlation and not just one population, but I've talked about more than one species, more than one genera, more than one family of frogs, but it turns out that these effects have been described independently in fish, reptiles, birds, and mammals, including humans, by people from around the world, not just my laboratory. So we're talking about every class of vertebrate that's been examined. I published a paper, for example, with a group of 22 scientists that I didn't know ahead of time from around the world, from 12 different countries, to show that demasculization and feminization of male gonads by atrazine was consistent across vertebrates. In fact, I coined the word gonadotoxin in this paper. Pissed them off. I read somewhere in a science paper that, like Homo sapiens, all language originated out of Africa. So I said, you know, I'm just doing what my people are good at. I'm just inventing some words like we've been doing since the beginning of time. What we showed in this paper is what I've showed you before. Here's amphibians, sperm in a testis, give him atrazine, no sperm. Here's fish, this is a guy in Belgium, sperm in a testis, give him atrazine, no sperm. This is a guy in Argentina who studies reptiles, sperm in a testis, give him atrazine, no sperm. This work was done in Nigeria and Croatia. Testicular tubule of a rat, sperm in a testis, give it atrazine, no sperm. And this is work from Pakistan in birds. Again, sperm in a testis, give it atrazine, no sperm. So this is work that's been duplicated in every vertebrate class around the world. What's more is this is a colleague of mine that shows that, in this case, rats, if you give them atrazine, the testicles are a lot smaller. This is a study from the colleague in Argentina. This is looking at a caiman. It's like a kind of like a big alligator. Here's the penis of the caiman. If you give it atrazine, it has a phallus that's intermediate between a male and a female. So it's causing a shrinkage of the genitals of these exposed males. Is the mechanism that atrazine causes a decline in testosterone and a decrease in sperm production? Again, I've shown you this in frogs, but this is a guy in England who shows the same thing in salmon. Here's a guy in Berkeley, me, who's shown the same thing in amphibians. And these are data from rats showing that if you give rats atrazine, testosterone declines. So again, it's an effect that we've seen across vertebrate classes. If you look at humans, here's control males. So these are men in Columbia, Missouri. These are subfertile men. So these are men who live in Columbia, Missouri, who are exposed to atrazine, who have atrazine in their urine. They have a low sperm count and can't get their wives pregnant. Now, again, it's not an experiment, it's just a correlation, but men in Columbia, Missouri, who have low sperm count and can't get their wives pregnant, have as much atrazine in their urine as we use to chemically castrate frogs and fish in the laboratory. Now, if I squash them, and these are data, these are not my data, these are independently published data. If I squash them down now, here's atrazine levels for men who work in fields with atrazine, and if I squash these data down now, here's, and again, these aren't my data, these are atrazine levels for men who apply atrazine, 2,400 parts per billion. So men who apply atrazine have 24,000 times the atrazine in their urine than we know is associated with subfertile men in Columbia, Missouri. Men who apply atrazine have 24,000 times the atrazine in their urine than we use to chemically castrate and feminize frogs and fish in the lab. Think about what that means. One of these guys could pee in a bucket. I could dilute their urine 24,000 times, and I can use the atrazine in their urine to chemically castrate and feminize 24,000 tanks of 30 tadpoles each. So now we're getting into some issues that's probably more relevant to this group, a term that I was introduced to, environmental justice or environmental racism, because 90% of these men are Mexican, Mexican-American, who not only are exposed to atrazine, they're exposed to chemicals like clopicrin, which was originally developed as a nerve gas in World War II. They're exposed to chemicals like 2,4-D, which was a component in Agent Orange. They have life expectancies of 50 in many of these migrant farm working communities. I think about things like now, if you look at California, and here's some things I learned in studying frogs. We're the fifth, at least we were when I made this slide, the fifth largest economy in the world. If California were its own country, we'd be the fifth richest country in the world. You know why? Because of agriculture. 1 in 10 jobs are in ag. 30% of the land is in ag. 350 agricultural products come out of California. And here's one that I did not know. 50%, half of the U.S.'s food comes from California. Half of the food that we eat, of the fruits, nuts, vegetables, and dairy come out of California. We use more pesticides than any state, and 90% of the workers are Hispanic. So if I put in red now the top 10 counties for agriculture in California, these are the 30% of the land that makes us the fifth largest economy in the world. If I plot onto that now the 30 poorest towns in California, where do you think they are? So the people who make us the fifth largest economy in the world are the targets of chemicals that we know are associated with adverse health outcomes. And that moved me in a very different way than just a little boy who likes frogs. On the other half of the equation, does atrazine induce aromatase? And we're not going to talk about vitellogenin and oogenesis or egg production in frogs, but aromatase and estrogen are important in things like breast cancer and prostate cancer, the top two cancers in men and women after lung cancer, and the leading cause of death in young men and women in the U.S. With regards to prostate cancer, there's an 8.4-fold increase and the incidence of prostate cancer in men who work in their factory in San Gabriel, Louisiana, compared to men who work in the factory but don't bag the atrazine in a community that's 80% black or 80% African American. With regards to breast cancer, there's at least one study here. If you like the p-values, I'll show it to you. This shows that women who live in a community where the well water is contaminated with atrazine are more likely to get breast cancer than women who live in that community but don't drink the well water. And that's just a correlation, but if you look at rats, testosterone goes down with atrazine exposure, estrogen goes up concomitantly, and in those same rats, and this is a study published by the manufacturer, there's a significant increase in the incidence of mammary cancer in rats that have atrazine in their drinking water. So it's just a correlation in humans, but we can reproduce that effect in rats that are supposed to model humans. In humans also, if you take cell lines that don't normally express aromatase and estrogen and give them atrazine, they start expressing aromatase and making estrogen. Just like we've seen in fish, just like we've seen in amphibians, just like we've seen in reptiles, just like we've seen in birds, Now we're talking about rodents and human cell lines, which are much more relevant to us. I went to visit him. I still think their name should be spelled with an I, but they don't listen to me. The point is, they have a pipe that runs straight into the Mississippi River. 1.2 million pounds of atrazine flow into the Gulf of Mexico every year. In a community that most of it looks like this. What's more is, if you look at, and again, I'm just a little boy who likes frogs, but if you look at the top 13 cancers that you're likely to get in the United States, and if I put in red now the ones that you're more likely to get if you're black, if you're African American, 11 out of the 13, you're more likely to get if you're black. If I look at now the mortality rate for these cancers, you're more likely to die from 13 out of 13 if you're black, if you're African American. Is that a biological difference, or is it that if you're black or Hispanic, you're more likely to live in and more likely to work in areas where you're exposed to chemicals that we know are associated with adverse health outcomes? My colleagues who study cancer say that less than 10% of cancer is a genetic issue. So when the doctor tells you that you're more likely to get breast cancer if your sister or your daughter or your mother or somebody in your family has breast cancer, is that genetics or is that just saying that, well, you've been exposed to the same crap that the rest of your family has? And when I think about things like Coleman for the Cure, and they invited me to give a talk, they don't give me no money, but they like for me to come talk. I entitled my last talk, An Ounce of Prevention. They didn't invite me back. The point is, all the cell lines we use to study these cancers aren't from minorities. So even if we do find the cure, it may not be relevant to the people who are more likely to get and more likely to die from the cancers that we've been studying. In fact, if you look at breast cancer cells, and this is from a student of mine, a former graduate student, and she's shown that, just like we've shown in everything else, that if you give these breast cancer cells atrazine, they start to express aromatase. Sort of a bad news situation, right? Because breast cancer depends on aromatase. In fact, your blood levels of estrogen are lower than they will ever be in your entire life when you get breast cancer after menopause. But the local expression of aromatase is important. You make that estrogen, the cancer cells themselves, and those damaged cells turn into cancer cells and then tumors that spread. In fact, the number one treatment for breast cancer right now is a chemical called letrozole, which decreases aromatase and decreases estrogen, and that's what's used now to treat your breast cancer. How is that impacted by the number one contaminant of drinking water, atrazine, which does exactly the opposite, increases aromatase, increases estrogen, induces breast cancer in rats, and is associated with breast cancer in humans? Here's where I really got in trouble, because I pointed out that Novartis Oncology offers treatments for cancers that range from breast cancer, et cetera. Yeah, so the same company that gives us 80 million pounds of aromatase inducer atrazine gives us the number one treatment for breast cancer that knocks out aromatase. So if you have breast cancer and you're taking letrozole to treat your breast cancer, how is that impacted by the other chemical made by the same company that does exactly the opposite? I published a paper called The One-Stop Shop, Chemical Causes and Cures for Breast Cancer. Yeah, they wrote a lot of letters to my dean. Because the point is, and here's what I'm saying, the point is, and this is all their published stuff, Syngenta wrote in response to my paper, while Syngenta does share some corporate history with Novartis and AstraZeneca, it has been completely independent of both since November 2000. Syngenta simply does not manufacture cell pharmaceutical products. Okay, fair enough. But in 2000, Syngenta wrote, the observed induction of aromatase, the rate-limiting enzyme, and a conversion of androgens to estrogens may be an underlying explanation for some of the reported hormonal-disrupting and tumor-promoting properties of these herbicides in vivo. In that same year, in July 2000, a marketing application for first-line letrozole treatment of postmenopausal women was submitted to the FDA by Syngenta. So all I'm saying is it's an interesting coincidence that in January of 2000, they discovered that atrazine induces aromatase and promotes breast cancer. Coincidentally, in July 2000, they start selling an aromatase blocker to treat breast cancer. And just coincidentally, in November 2000, they stop selling atrazine and spin off this other agrochemical company to sell atrazine. I'm just saying, it's an interesting set of coincidences. In conclusion, I think that my interest in this aquatic organism has told me quite a bit about this aquatic organism. In fact, we now know that we will be exposed to over 300 synthetic chemicals before we leave the womb, most of which we have no idea. The best thing about atrazine is at least we know what it does. For the other 299, we have no idea. Linda Birnbaum from the National Institutes of Environmental Health says, In 2009, I'm very concerned about the general population exposure to atrazine. We don't really know what these chemicals do to fetuses or prepubescent children. We have a pretty good idea because we know from rats that it causes prostate and mammary cancer. We know that it causes immune failure, which we've also shown in frogs. We know that it causes neural damage, which we've also shown in frogs. We know that from the EPA labs, atrazine causes abortion because of the chemical imbalance it creates when pregnant females are exposed. Of those rats that don't abort, we know that the sons are born with prostate disease. The sons are born with the prostate of an old man. We know that of those rats that don't abort, the daughters are born with impaired mammary development. Their mammary glands don't grow such that when their offspring grow up, they have retarded growth and development. And here's what I think is important. Here's what I think is incredibly important. This study by the EPA, the third EPA laboratory, shows that this rat never saw atrazine. This rat was affected by atrazine that its grandmother was exposed to. This rat never saw atrazine. This rat was affected by atrazine that its grandmother was exposed to. So I think in terms of the ethical issues that we need to think about, the idea that my daughter, that my grandchildren could be affected by chemicals that we're using today moves me in a very different way. It moves me in a very different way because this is not just some made-up thing. We now have data. I mean, so here's a colleague who shows that if you get pregnant during peak atrazine contamination, you're more likely to have babies with birth defects. Those birth defects include, and I apologize for the images I'm about to show, an increase in gastroschisis. Who knows what that is? I had no idea what that is. But if you're exposed to atrazine, your maternal exposure is associated with fetal gastroschisis. This is a photograph from a former student of mine who's now studying this issue. It's when intestines are born outside of the baby's body. Another paper from the Center for Disease Control shows that if you're exposed to atrazine, you're more likely to have a baby with choanal atresia. That's where the oral and nasal cavity don't fuse, and so the baby has a hole in its face. And the last one I'll show, it's again published by the National Institutes of Health, showing that there's a correlation between residential atrazine and male genital malformations. And I'm going to end on this one because, for a particular reason, that's scientific based. They show that, I won't read you the whole thing, that if you are pregnant with a son and exposed to atrazine, you're more likely to have a baby with hypospadias. That's where the urethra doesn't end through the penis. You're more likely to have a baby with cryptorchidism. That's where the testes don't descend into the scrotum. You're more likely to have a baby with microphallus. That's where the penis actually doesn't grow. And the reason I show these is because it's incredibly important to my research, because male genital development is dependent on androgens, and estrogen exposure will induce all of these malformations. And you're more likely to get these malformations if you're exposed to a chemical that we know in every vertebrate class that's been examined, a chemical that decreases androgens and increases estrogens. So I'll stop there and address questions and comments. And if you want to go into more details about Syngenta's other antics, we can do that as well. But thank you very much for your time and your attention.
Could you explain in more detail how you became involved with the company to begin with? Was this a project where you were being paid, or they were paying the lab, the university that funded your salary? The reason this is of interest is that sometimes there's so much concern about company-funded research that professors don't get involved in it at all. And mm-hmm. then if you had not gotten involved with this company at all to begin with, would you have ever gotten into this issue independently? So I'd just like to hear a little bit more about how you got involved with the company, and then if you never had been approached by the company, whether you would have probably gone down this road and done this research on your own.
So again, my interests are in the role of hormones in development in amphibians. So I had identified the endpoints, if you will. So I knew that androgens control the larynx and estrogens control the gonads, et cetera. So I had the model, if you will. I had some involvement because we had patented another species of amphibian to be used for exactly this kind of screening and detecting. And I also had a graduate student in my laboratory who had worked with somebody who had studied endocrine disruptors. So somebody who had come out of Gainesville with a person named Lou Gillette. So the stage was sort of set for it. We had the patent. I would sort of lose modesty enough to say I was kind of up and coming and kind of known in the field. But I had never heard of atrazine. I don't think I ever would have been involved in atrazine. Maybe, who knows? But it was literally because the company said, well, we want you to be on this panel in those multiple connections that I showed you. And I think their strategy was, and probably still is, to get young assistant professors to get you hooked on the funding, especially in a time when federal funding for support is diminishing, especially in a time when it's very difficult to get funding to do the kind of screening and testing and toxicology. Most of that's funded by the field. And it is, at a time when we as young scientists were being encouraged at the time that you have to diversify, right? I mean, there was a time when the National Science Foundation funded careers. And I don't think that's necessarily the case anymore, at least not the way that they used to, at least not the way that I knew from my people who came ahead of me. But it was a way to be beneficial for a young scientist, but it was also a way for the company to get control over when the data came out and how it was done, because otherwise it's difficult for other laboratories to do that kind of work. Most of the work you see coming out on any kind of chemicals on the market is going to be funded by the manufacturer.
It's not approved. Regulators do not approve of it in Europe. Mm-hmm. And you presented that as some indication of its not being a good product that should be used here. But we've heard a lot about European opposition to GMOs. Mm-hmm. And scientists continually say that this is in opposition or contraindication to the data that actually say GMOs are as safe as non-GMO products. So I was wondering whether you thought that the fact that the Europeans were opposed to it was in any indication of the validity of the response. I mean, you presented lots of other data that's independent, but it may be that that the Europeans respond negatively to something is not always an indication that it's a proper response. Or do you think that their response to GMOs is also correct? I'm just curious about that. The other thing was a slightly different take on lowering testosterone and destroying sperm. Many people would like to see testosterone lowered, and many people would like to see a male contraceptive. So I'm just wondering whether any of your work, without these bad side effects, has led people to think about how one could actually find a male contraceptive, or maybe reduce the bad effects of testosterone.
Okay, that's a lot. One is, my most obnoxious answer is, I think in Europe, maybe I won't offend the Europeans. I think there's such a long history of screwing up the environment that they're much more cautious. And the precautionary principle rules in Europe. And the reason that atrazine was banned is their argument is that if something's detectable in the water that has the potential to do harm, it is gone unless the company can prove that it's safe. And that's a very difficult thing to do. Whereas in this country, a chemical is innocent until proven guilty. So the company's charged with proving that a chemical's bad, which is an easy thing not to do. And that is the big difference. I think, like, for example, when I show these correlations with birth defects and things like that, the European Union is saying, we're not going to wait for more data. There's enough data, and we know that there's exposure, and so it's gone. Okay. In terms of the GMOs, my personal opinion, I'm not advocating for GMOs. My personal opinion is that maybe in some cases not all the science is there. My problem, and which I'll talk about tomorrow in our discussion, my problem with GMOs is the following. When I was here at Harvard 30 years ago, the big discussion, I don't think we call them GMOs then, but the big discussion was about frost-resistant strawberries and drought-resistant wheat and eventually BT corn. And I would have a very different opinion if that's what we were talking about. What we're talking about now, though, is the majority of GMOs, and I'm going to make up a number, 90%, are all for making crops that are pesticide resistant so that we can use more pesticides. And I have a slide that I can show you where that problem comes from. 90% of the seeds that we use to grow our food are owned by six chemical companies. And those are the six chemical companies that are generating the GMOs that are interested in mainly hooking you not only to the seed, it's a business model, but also hooking you to the chemical that goes with the seed. And it's a sinister plot in the sense that if you choose not to use a GMO product and you choose to use Roundup Ready product, one, the Roundup that you spray on your field is going to kill your crops. Two, if your pollen or your seed blows on his field, you're going to own his field then the next year. And even if that doesn't happen, you're going to outgrow him, whether or not we need the product, and so he's out of business. And that's what I'm saying. That's my issue with GMO, is the conflict of interest associated with the political economics. In the case of corn, my issue is also that it's not about, you'll hear Syngenta say stuff like, oh, we're feeding the world. Bullshit. We eat less than 2% of the corn that we grow. Atrazine increases corn yield by 1.2%. The majority of corn that we grow goes to ethanol production and is all tied up in the ethanol, clean fuel, renewable fuel lobby. It has nothing to do with growing food. It has to do with, again, a chemical company controlling the products that we use to grow our food. And I forget what your other question was.
The relation to reducing testosterone.
Oh. The short answer to that, that's a long conversation. I teach an entire lecture on this. The short answer to that, male contraception is easy, right? We have so much contraception for a female. If you're a female, your hormone levels are different every day of the month. If you're a male, you're doing the same thing every day. If you can control a female's reproductive cycle with the changes between the follicular phase and the post-ovulatory phase, of course you can do it in men. The problem is one of social. And it includes, if you look at things like tubal ligation versus vasectomy. Vasectomy is a simple thing. You go into the doctor's office. Don't get me wrong, you're hurt, but you go into the doctor's room. It's a local anesthetic, a simple surgery. But look at the frequency of people who get vasectomy versus tubal ligation. So it's a socialized one. The problem is not that we don't have male contraception. It's that, what's that old joke, that nobody would trust a man to take it. So the problem is one that's social. You don't need atrazine. There's a number of different ways that you can do it. Yeah. Oh, we know how to do that. We know how to do that. It's just that the Y chromosomes won't do it. Even the surgery, right? The surgery is much easier. But look at the frequency of men who have it versus women.
So you have to get rid of the testosterone first.
Maybe that's. Well, I mean, you know, the example I use in my class that I've used for years is, and maybe we shouldn't go into this here, but is the example of Depo-Provera. So the injectable progestin birth control that's used in women, that multiple cases have come up with men who are, for example, convicted child molesting rapists who say, I want to get Depo-Provera to decrease my sex drive. And it's been ruled multiple times as cruel and inhumane punishment because we don't understand the side effects. But millions of women are taking the same chemical every day around the world. And the World Health Organization even recommends that women take it in Africa to control birth when it's known that Depo-Provera is associated with an increase in HIV transmission. Yet it's cruel and unusual punishment for a serial child rapist to take the exact same chemical. So it's a social political problem where there's more emphasis placed on the male health and reproduction than there is on women.
So. Thank you.
So I have a very simple question, which starts this whole thing off. Why is a chemical company that already has a U.S. approval studying the effects of their chemical? Why are they involved with you in the very first place?
I think part of it is that map I showed you with all the connections. So most of the chemicals, people always ask, well, how could the EPA let this get on the market? Most of the chemicals that we use now in agriculture came on the market after World War II in the 1940s and 50s. The EPA did not exist until 1972. So there are laws and regulatory practices that require chemicals to come up for re-review and re-regulation. So the correct. My understanding is all chemicals have to come up for review. So the companies have these panels set up, like I showed you with the guy Ron Kendall, so that they can stay ahead of the game. And if you have somebody on your panel that's also in the EPA, you know what's coming down. So you can stay ahead by going, okay, we're already doing that. So the idea is when the EPA comes, you can say, oh, we're already spending millions of dollars to get Dr. Hayes to study this. And then the EPA says, okay, see, it's self-regulated. But now the company has control over the data.
it seemed to me you proved that it was guilty. You said that this chemical is guilty, so why doesn't the EPA remove it from the market? Is there corruption at the EPA? What's your explanation
for that? Well, I've shown you some of the corruption. Some of that we'll talk about tomorrow. The EPA made the statement regarding my work that I think the quote was, the ultimate decision on whether or not to ban atrazine is much bigger than science. It weighs in public opinion and it takes into account economics. So the EPA weighs, here, I'll read you exactly what the EPA says. Okay, so it's not just about the science. The EPA says, this is some stuff that I would reserve for tomorrow. The EPA says, quote, a monetary value is designed to disease, impairments, and shorten lives and weighed against the benefits of keeping a chemical in use. So even if the science is there, well, there it is, right? They have some equation. And the difference is, and the things that I'll get into in our discussion tomorrow, is the people who bear the burdens, the people who bear those costs, aren't the same people who are getting those monetary benefits. But that's how the EPA works, right? According to their own statement.
I'm sure I'm from Corporate Accountability International. We're committing to a non-profit organization that challenges corporations for abuses of public health and the environment. My question is basically, so one of the campaigns that we run are against is against the tobacco industry, which actually has, you know, used or probably pioneered many of these tactics. That's the same people. Right, exactly.
I can give you names of the exact same people who worked in the tobacco industry and, believe it or not, who worked for the airlines after 9/11 are the exact same people working on the campaigns for the chemical companies.
Crazy. I would like
Jim Tozzi is one name you should look up.
Right. So, you know, you've raised a lot of, you know, very alarming issues here, and I would love to hear about some, you know, recommendations on next steps about what people can do systematically in the same way that the industries have, you know, kind of used the same plays over and over to preempt regulation through revolving doors, so on and so forth.
That's a good question. I mean, I've worked quite a bit with both with publicity, for example, being in documentaries and writing popular things. I've worked with a number of legislators, both in the U.S. as well as abroad, who are trying to ban atrazine. I've worked with the EPA, and I've also worked with litigators who've actually successfully sued Syngenta to get things out. The problem is, well, I guess the problems are severalfold. One is, I think, there are tactics that you can use that somebody who's, in my opinion, of ethical and moral standing will not use those same tactics. Some of them more subtle, some of them not so subtle. Even in the language, for example. So the scientists who work for the company will say things like, we have proven this. And in my opinion, a real scientist would say, well, you know, the evidence supports this, but not that. And that sounds wishy-washy to, you know, somebody who's reading this stuff on the web. The other problem is I never really understood what the word lobbyist meant till I got involved in this. And so maybe once a year, I'll work with a group like Pesticide Action Network or Natural Resource Defense Council who will have a lobby day where you'll go to Washington, D.C., and you'll go and talk to as many congresspeople as you possibly can. Syngenta's got somebody there every single day at $1,000 a day. And what I've learned is a politician's job is to get reelected. Not to understand atrazine and not to understand the health implications of atrazine, but to get reelected. And if somebody's telling them, people really want atrazine, people really want atrazine, people really want atrazine every day, then that's what they believe. And if somebody comes around once a year and says, here are the dangers of atrazine, they don't remember that. And in the case of atrazine, which is regulated by the EPA, and the EPA is regulated by or headed by an administrator, is appointed by the president, you're not going to go on a political campaign with the first presidential caucus in Iowa and talk about appointing somebody to the EPA that's going to regulate the number one crop in your state. I mean, so it's just, you can use the same tactics, but I don't think that the average person has the power of a corporation. I mean, right? So we could. If whatever organization for whatever issue had the money for at $1,000 a day to put somebody in the office, to put somebody in Washington, D.C. every single day. So you can do it, but the effectiveness is.
So what is the strong case one could make for atrazine? I mean, we know the Roundup. There's no case to be made for it long term. But what can you make for atrazine?
I mean,
besides
right.
potentially downregulating a pesky male hormone, what use is atrazine in agriculture? I mean, what is the strongest case you can make for it?
The strongest case you make to keep it?
Yeah.
Economics. 1.1. My understanding is 1.2% increase in yield is $100 million a year.
And that's demonstrated. That's sure.
So they say. I mean, it's also psychological, right? So I like people ask me all the time, like, well, how do you go and do these studies on farms? The farmers must be standing there with shotguns. Said, no, the farmers are out there collecting frogs with me. But what the farmers said, what I've had many farmers say to me is that I know this stuff is bad, but if I don't use it this year and my neighbor does, then I no longer have a farm in the next year. Because if he grows 1.2% more than me and can sell less than me, then I no longer have a farm. And you don't have a fight when the person you're buying the seed from is a chemical company. And for the fungus, I haven't even talked about the fungicides yet, but the seeds for corn and just about everything else comes coated with the fungicide already. It's almost impossible even as a corporate farmer or as a, even a small farmer to buy a seed that doesn't even already have the pesticide on it. So it's a very strong strategy. I mean, this is something they thought out very well.
I know you may talk about this tomorrow, but we're talking a lot at Harvard now about climate change and Professor Naomi Oreskes' film, The Merchants of Doubt. Can you talk a bit more about the Merchants of Doubt in the about pesticides and their relationship not only to EPA but USDA, FDA, Congress, et cetera?
Yeah, I'll talk more about that tomorrow. So the company, I showed some of the science that they used to try to generate that doubt and the idea that, well, we couldn't repeat the work, and there are all kinds of things, comments that they've made that I'll show that I'll show tomorrow. But in addition, the sort of the personal attacks and the personal crusade to discredit me, which is now all very well documented because they actually wrote it down and turned it into a judge, and now it's public information. And so that was the whole idea. I mean, especially with, I mean, I think social media and the internet is a blessing in many, many ways, right? But then also you get on, even I get on, and sometimes it's difficult to tell, well, what's real science and what's not real science? And I think they're doing a much better job than, you know, many of the nonprofit organizations in using that kind of confusion and that kind of doubt and linking it to other things. I mean, even I get linked to things where I'm like, I never said that. But they're actually enjoying and using that strategy to make that happen. There's a film and a book called Manufacturers of Doubt, another similar, I can't remember the exact title now, that goes through that whole strategy. So again, in many ways, the internet's made information much more accessible, but it's also made it much more difficult and confusing. Like my mom, that's the reason I make the point about my mom, is that one of the changes that I think has to happen is that we in the ivory tower have to give more weight and put more importance on people who are actually trying to make that difference in a public domain.
Does glyphosate also affect your relatives?
I don't know much about glyphosate at all, and I don't know of any science that's convinced me of the kinds of things that I look at and the kinds of mechanisms that I look at that show that glyphosate's in the same class in terms of being an endocrine disruptor as atrazine is. I understand now it's been listed by the World Health Organization as a likely carcinogen or probable carcinogen, but I don't know the data that have led up to that decision and that designation.
Thank you very much.